Welcome everybody to our second, I believe our second Psych Talks of this semester. Today we have Kashia. I want to make sure I say that correctly.
Yep, you're good, no worries.
Thank you. Who is going to be presenting her work on autism and physical health and building a network around that at UCLA. Kashia is a former alum here at Humboldt State University. She has since moved on to UCLA, where she will be completing her PhD in the next term, I believe, is what UCLA works on. After which, Kashia will be moving on to becoming a faculty member at UCLA, where she will continue to do research and teach, where she currently is at. So without further ado, and for the sake of time, I'm going to turn it over to Kashia. And please, everybody, join me in giving her a warm round of applause, either through emojis or a camera.
Thank you very much. Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for having me here today. As Erin had said, please feel free to put questions in the chat. And also, I'm very casual, so you can also unmute. If you're comfortable, you can unmute and ask a question. Feel free to interrupt me at any time. It is no problem at all. And I'm happy to make this as interactive as you will, as you are able to, or as we're able to. So my name is Kashia Rosenau. I completed my bachelor's in psychology and my master's in academic research with an emphasis in developmental psychopathology from HSU, and had a phenomenal experience receiving my bachelor's and master's at Humboldt. As some of the professors on the call who had me in classes know, I tend to talk extremely fast and mumble, so please feel free. Sorry, I'm laughing watching Chris or Dr. Everson laugh, probably reminiscing from many presentations in his classes. So please feel free to interrupt or to write in the chat if I am going too fast or if there's anything that I've said that doesn't make sense or really anything at all. I'm happy to pause or stop at any moment in time. So I'm going to talk today about autism and physical health, and then about the Autism Intervention Research Network on physical health that we're creating with the National Coordinating Center based out of UCLA. So this project is funded by HRSA, which is the Health Resources and Services Administration, and it's under the Maternal, Child, and Health Bureau. So what kind of is the state of autism and physical health? If any of you are not quite as familiar with autism, autism is a neurodevelopmental disability, and it usually impacts individuals in areas of social communication, social interaction, and then also some repetitive and rigid behaviors. Autism is pretty heterogeneous, meaning that there's a saying that if you've met one autistic person, you've met one autistic person, because there's quite a lot of variability within the population. So some individuals need more help with daily living skills and will need a caretaker throughout their life. And other individuals are yourselves, your classmates, your professors, people that you see every day. So let's talk more specifically about autism and physical health. So relative to their non-autistic peers, autistic youth and adults have significantly more physician's visits, higher costs of medical care. And there's also pretty pronounced racial, ethnic, and gender health disparities in access to quality medical services. A lot of this exists in the general population, which has been highlighted over the past 12 months now, especially. But there are some pretty profound inequalities within autism research and access to care, especially. So the medical home model is one thing that can be effective in trying to increase the quality of physical health for autistic individuals. So the medical home is hopefully used more and more in practice. But what it is it's more of a comprehensive care program. So some primary care providers are able to operate under this medical home model. So it's really family-centered care, culturally appropriate. So focusing on different aspects that might impact that individual unique aspects based off of their culture, based off of the area that they were born or where they're being raised or the types of, you know, jobs that their parents have, or if they're with a caregiver, you know, or foster care. So the medical home is really focused on providing this comprehensive and coordinated care. So one of the clinics that I work in is the LEN clinic, which is the Leadership and Education of Neurodevelopmental Disabilities. And we provide a medical home where we have, so I'm the developmental psychologist that's there in the clinic. We have, it's run by Dr. Alice Kuo, who is the chief of internal medicine and pediatrics for UCLA. So internal medicine and pediatrics just means that those MDs are double boarded to be able to work both in children and in adults. So in the LEN clinic, we have MDs, psychologists, social workers, neurologists, psychiatrists, so really a lot of different individuals from quite a few different disciplines, so that we can provide a more comprehensive care to our patients and then also connect with other services. So we have some admin staff who can help connect individuals with services in their community. We have a lot, because there are so many of us, we also can do a lot more follow-up and connect with other specialty services that individuals need to receive. So it's kind of like a best case scenario for care within our current system of, you know, medical care that we have here in the United States. Unfortunately, most individuals, and including those with autism, don't have access to this medical home model. I'll talk a little bit more in the lecture today about what is often referred to as kind of this ivory tower within research and these, like, you know, best case scenario of how things can happen. But how do we actually translate that into like a real world setting? And how do we make a broader impact on a, you know, on a larger amount of people by trying to translate what we can do in research to what actually happens in practice, and not just in practice in, you know, in cities, in areas that have high resources, you know, but in the, you know, in the neighborhoods that the more inner city neighborhoods, and then also in rural environments where individuals don't have access to all of these different, you know, specialists and this team of, you know, 8 individuals that can meet with them monthly. So not having access to this medical home model ends up with quite a few unmet needs with physical, mental health, lower rates of immunizations, and then also greater odds of using the emergency department. So the National Autism Indicators Reports are something that's put out by the team at Drexel, the A.J. Drexel Autism Institute at Drexel University. And what they did is, it started quite a few years ago, and they looked at the landscape of autism research. Paul Shattuck is the researcher who started this work, but he looked at the landscape of autism research and kind of where, you know, how much money was going into it, where that money was being funneled, and, you know, what types of research was being produced by that. So once he started to look into that, he realized that there's a lot of information that wasn't really digestible, you know, wasn't presented in a way that was really digestible for the layperson, and even including for a lot of researchers, you know, there's a lot of scattered information. So the National Autism Indicators Reports try to take that information. They focus on a different topic at different points in time, but they try to take that information and combine it, so they get everything that they can on a specific area, and then they put that out. They're great at creating the infographics and all of those different figures that are really helpful, that we're especially a lot more used to, you know nowadays, where we see things presented in a way that's a little bit more easy on the eyes and easily digestible. So the National Autism Indicators Reports try to do that. So they recently published one on health and healthcare. And they saw, when they were asking parents about the rates of co-occurring conditions for their children with autism, every single one of them across the board had higher rates within autistic individuals, except for asthma. They also found that certain conditions varied in prevalence based off of race and ethnicity, as I alluded to before. So ADHD and anxiety specifically were more commonly reported in white non-Hispanic children, and asthma and developmental delay were more common in Black and non-Hispanic children. There also are many psychiatric and medical conditions that are more common in transition age youth. So this is individuals that are, you know, ending high school and then, you know, going into adulthood, more like emerging adulthood. So there are more psychiatric and medical conditions in transition age youth with autism than any other transition age youth. So those without autism and other co-occurring additions, including obesity, anxiety, and epilepsy. So when you think about this, like these aren't just figures that we're reading about in these, you know, in these giant reports, but we're actually seeing that across the board, there's some pretty significant disparities that are happening related to physical health and autism. So where do we go from here? One question that I like to ask individuals, just to kind of understand the impact of this, is that you hear the numbers of, you know, like 1 in 54, I think is the current statistic for how often children are diagnosed with autism, is 1 in 54 children have autism. But what does that really mean when we translate it to like the general population? So do you think that there are more people with autism, more people with red hair, or more people with green eyes in the general population? You can drop your answer in the chat if you feel comfortable. What do you think there are more people with? Autism, green eyes, or red hair? I have 2 out of 3. I'm seeing quite a few responses of autism. So it's actually quite comparable. So the CDC estimates that around 2 to 2.5% of the adult population has autism. That includes those that are, autism with green eyes, beautiful. So the 2 to 2.5 statistic, that includes individuals who have also not been diagnosed. So there have been some pretty big advances in diagnosis in the last decade and even in the last few years. We're able to diagnose individuals quite a bit earlier in life. And then also due to, you know, decreasing stigma associated with autism and really big increases in the neurodiversity movement, which we'll talk about a little bit more in a few minutes, we see that more adults with autism are coming out and talking about their lives and possibly getting tested or identifying as being an autistic person. One note, I use the term autistic person instead of person with autism. In the disability community and with autism activists, that seems to be what's generally preferred. However, I strongly caution individuals to ask because some people prefer to be called a person with autism and other people prefer autistic person. Is it possible that people are being falsely diagnosed with autism on a mass scale? I hesitate to touch on, but it's definitely possible that people are being falsely diagnosed. And it's also very possible that people are being underdiagnosed. There are quite a few possible reasons for recent increases in autism diagnoses. Like I said, they've gotten better at being able to diagnose autism in some ways, although there still is a lot of room for improvement there and more inclusive and less expensive tools are definitely needed for autism diagnosis. The assessments for diagnosis have gotten better. Also, people have just become more aware about autism, right? So is it that we're assessing more people and then finding more people with autism? Is it that people are, it's easier, you know, more easily spotted and talked about? Or is it that we are actually seeing an increase in the amount of people who have autism because it's related to some, you know, environmental factor? We're not really sure. We do know from the genetics literature that approximately 20 to 30% of individuals with autism, it has some sort of a genetic component, but we see that in about 20 to 30%. And it's not just one, there is no autism gene. It's a multitude of different genes. And it also, so I could have, one autism indicator in my genomic sequence, but not actually display autism, and another individual could have that same exact gene and be severely impacted by their autism. So when I say there's the genetic component of it, it's not, just focusing on one autism gene. Yes, I agree. We definitely need to advocate to help individuals be able to get access to effective diagnostic tools for autism. So where do we go from here? One of the areas that I have started working a lot in is primary care. So some specific research priorities related to primary care that might be able to help with some of these disparities that I was just discussing are enhancing primary care provider training. So providing more information for primary care, you know, doctors, and your primary care doctor is the one that you go to when you get your flu shot or, you know, you're for a yearly physical, if anybody actually does those as we are supposed to, or if you have, you know, a cold or, you know, some sort of an illness that you're trying to figure out if it's more severe, then your primary care doctor is the person that you typically go to. So enhancing their training on autistic individuals would be really helpful. Promoting self-determination for autistic individuals themselves, and then also improving mental health and psychiatric care. So I always want to note that some of these things that I'm talking about are things that would also be really helpful for the general population, right? So we need better access to mental health care in the United States in general, right? And psychiatric care. Because autistic people are exactly that, they're people. There are some disparities that are especially prominent in the autistic population. However, a lot of the things that would help autistic people would also just be helpful for the entire population as a whole. So the Autism Intervention Research Network on Physical Health is something that was created to try to be able to have an impact on some of these disparities. It has been around for at least 15 years now. There's an AARP for physical health and also an AARB for behavioral health. The AARP, the study of the project that I'm talking about now, was originally at Mass General. It was in Boston for the last like decade or 15 years, and then was recently just awarded to our team at UCLA at the beginning of September. So as a grant or a cooperative agreement is what it's technically labeled as. As that goes, we're relatively young because we just were funded at the beginning of September, but we have been quite busy in that amount of time. So the goal of the AARP, and I'm sorry, I'll try to minimize the amount of acronyms that I use throughout this talk, but the goal of the AARP is to try to increase the quality of, you know, of life for autistic individuals by addressing some of the disparities in physical health and also trying to increase overall well-being. And one of the ways that we're trying to do that is by really integrating autistic individuals in a meaningful way. We'll find research networks are, this isn't the only research network that exists for autism and in general, right? Research networks are something that are becoming increasingly more common where funding is put towards them. Sometimes they'll include, you know, community stakeholders. So, you know, autistic individuals or whoever the population is that they're focused around, but oftentimes it can be a bit tokenistic and their feedback isn't, you know, really included in a way that can actually impact meaningful change. So that's one thing that we are really conscious of within the AARP network. And I'll talk about a few ways that we are trying to tackle that in a minute. But that definitely is a lens that that impacts the way that we look at everything within the network. So as I said, the National Coordinating Center for the AARP is at UCLA. Dr. Alice Kuo, the chief of MedPeds, is the primary or principal investigator for the AARP. She's one of my main mentors. And so that's the top box here. And then we have these four main groups that really help make all of this possible and that also help us try to get the information out to the people, if you will. So AUCD, which manages the data repository and the network management, AUCD is a really cool organization. If any of you have any interest in working in anything related to the disability field, not just autism, but anywhere along disabilities at all, I strongly encourage you to look at AUCD. So AUCD is the Association of University Centers on Disabilities. They have quite a few self-advocates who work for their organization, work for them, and then also work with them. And it's 133 different university centers across the United States. they have LEND programs. I mentioned LEND earlier because that's how we have our interdisciplinary clinic, is through the LEND program. But LEND programs are graduate training programs. I think there's 55 of them across the United States. They're the yellow squares here. There's one at UC Davis, one at UCLA, and one at CHLA, Children's Hospital of Los Angeles. Those are the three that are in California. But LEND programs fall underneath the umbrella of AUCD, and they provide some really high quality training regarding working in the disability space. So if any of you end up going on to, you know, additional graduate programs, then if there's a LEND program at your, you know, at your school and you have any interest in disabilities, I strongly encourage you to check them out. Yes. Are these more accessible to disabled people than general programs? Yes, they have a huge push. I think that you actually have to have a certain amount of individuals within your LEND program who identify as having a disability. You have to have individuals who have family members, so who have a disability. It really has to be focused on including the voices of disabled humans within the work. That's one of the big focuses of AUCD in general, and especially of their LEND programs. I was a LEND trainee at UCLA during my graduate studies, and I strongly suggest checking them out if you have any interest. Even looking at their website and their social media, they have quite a few interesting things. And you'll obviously see information about the AARP there, because we're partnering with them for this project. So since they already have this existing network of 133 university centers, we partnered with them for the AARP because they can do a great job of being able to disseminate information to individuals on a large scale, because they already have the infrastructure set up. The Autism Intervention, or I'm sorry, the Autistic Researchers Review Board, the ARRB, is a group of 8 autistic researchers. They're not all autism researchers, but they are all autistic. So some of them are autistic autism researchers. However, their research falls in quite a few different categories. And I'll talk a little bit more about this group later, but it's quite a diverse group of 8 individuals from across the United States. We have a few Canadians and one person who's in the UK, but they are kind of the second pillar on what makes up the AARP network. So then when we were starting to look into the possibility of applying for the funds to be able to create this network and bring this network to UCLA, we really wanted to focus on areas of research that or areas that need more research. So some of you may know that in autism research, it's really heavily focused in early intervention, which is amazing. If any of you have taken a class from Dr. Howe, you know that, you know, in the first 5 years of life, 95% of your brain develops. And that when we're talking about funding dollars, if we throw some money at the earlier ages, it usually like $1 to $7, or it makes a bigger impact at an earlier age than it does if we were to throw that same money at a later time point. So the early intervention is definitely needed. However, autistic people grow up and the world of, you know, of autism research seems to have kind of forgotten that. I think it's something like 1.8% of the funding for autism research, which is a few billion dollars, goes towards adults with autism. So our focus, while we treat and see individuals all across the lifespan, our focus is really on transition age youth. So kind of like emerging adulthood, and then pushing up into adulthood. So we looked at the research on physical health and autism and tried to identify areas that were in serious need of additional work. Some of these are areas that have almost nothing. And so we even need just, you know, baseline studies trying to understand where we are. So, you know, so we know where to go from there. And others have some work, but, you know, we need to, again, focus a little bit more on adults as well. So we have 6 nodes that I'll just talk about really briefly, but we have 6 nodes within the AARP that are focused in different areas and then have different experts that lead those nodes. So Dr. Alice Kuo, who's, you know, the principal investigator, leads the primary care services and quality node. So one of the main projects we're doing through this node, the first node here, is the LEND clinic I mentioned earlier, that interdisciplinary clinic that is a great model, but is expensive, is really high resource. and we can only see so many individuals per year, right? We are trying to write up more about exactly what we're doing in that interdisciplinary clinic and disseminate that information, especially for primary care MDs, for primary care providers across the nation. And we're using the AARP network to be able to do that. So I'll tell you a little bit more about that when we talk about the research engine. Our community-based lifestyle interventions node, they've really been busy, especially during COVID. We've seen quite a bit of an increase in obesity, you know, a lot of weight gain during pandemic times with individuals, not being as active as they normally are. There's quite a few sensory issues that are related to food within autistic individuals. A lot of nutrition interventions and things that are done from the community-based lifestyle interventions node. And those are Dr. Gragnani and Dr. Fernandez are two MDs at UCLA, preventative medicine MDs at UCLA. Then we have Lisa Crowan and Maria Masolo at Kaiser of Northern California, who focus on gender, sexuality, and reproductive health. There is very little research on autistic birthers, so on autistic individuals who are pregnant, and especially in their prenatal care and also in their postpartum period. So they are looking at some really interesting work related to autism in pregnancy. Also, there's quite a high occurrence of transgender individuals and gender non-binary. And then also when we're talking about sexuality, there's quite a bit of, variability within the spectrum of sexuality within autism. So they're also looking at some really cool work there, trying to understand a little bit more about how we can better serve individuals who are autistic, who need to be able to have better resources related to gender identity and sexual identity. The healthcare service or systems and services node is led by the team at Drexel that I mentioned earlier with the National Autism Indicators report. And they're looking at big data related to, Medicaid and public benefits and some bigger picture items there. Then we also have our neurology node based out of UCLA with Dr. Rajutha Wilson. There's a high co-occurring rate of seizure disorders and epilepsy within autism. So there's quite a bit of work to do there. And then one of the nodes that's been really interesting because of the way that it is thought about is genetics, led by Julian Martinez at UCLA. A lot of genetics research in autism originally was focused on curing autism, figuring out what the cause is so that they could try to eradicate it. That's definitely not the approach that we're taking here. We're looking a lot more at some of the co-occurring rare and orphan diseases that are commonly co-occurring with autism, because helping individuals to be able to collect data and find more information about occurrence rates with some of these rare disorders can also help them find possible treatment for the rare disorders themselves, while also being able to assist with services related to their autism. Has there been much research on autism and intimate partner violence? Not that I know of. I haven't seen many survivor support resources focusing on autism and survivorship. No, I know that there's some work focused more so on autism and sexual abuse, just because individuals with disabilities and neurodevelopmental disabilities are oftentimes targeted for different areas of abuse. I know that there is some research there, but I'm not sure about intimate partner violence specifically. I'll drop my email in the chat before we finish today, and feel free to reach out to me and I can reach out to some colleagues and see if they have any more information. Yeah, of course. So from the AUCD network of the 133 university centers, we communicated with them and found a minimum of 15 who would sign on to this project from the beginning. Because again, our goal is to try to create more research in the areas where it's needed, but then be able to disseminate that information to the people that need it the most. So we are starting with these 15 different collaborating research entities, CREs, to be able to get the information out there, and then also for them to work on some of our studies. So those are the four kind of main components of the AARP structure. We also will be working on, or we've just released actually, a pilot and feasibility funding program. This iteration is only open to individuals related to one of the CREs or the research nodes at institutions that are related to those places. However, our future iterations will be available to anyone. And we're trying to provide more funding for early stage researchers. So graduate students, postdoctoral fellows, early stage faculty who are trying to do more work in this area. So that's our pilot and feasibility funding program. We're also creating a AARP scholars program to help provide mentorship for individuals who want to get into this area and maybe don't have a specific project they need funding for, but really just want to learn more about autism and physical health and more ways that they could possibly make a difference. So we're creating a mentorship program for that, with that in mind. As of right now, we have them combined together so that we're providing some funding for a project along with mentorship, but starting next year, those will be separated into two. And then at, you know, at conferences, sometimes you get an email ahead of time that's like, come a day early and do this, or go to Chris Aberson's stats workshops at WPA or a different variety of things. So we are actually including half day research, like a research conference on a couple of different conferences. The AUCD has an annual conference every year. And then the CARES conference. So the CARES Act helped provide funding for autism research. So there's a conference that's focused around that. And then since we do also need to get information out there to, you know, to researchers, we will do an annual supplement. So we publish, we just finished submitting everything for our first supplement. I think it's like 20 to 30 articles that are focused around autism and physical health that will be published in the journal Pediatrics every year to show what the network has been doing, but then also get more information out there for researchers so that they can, you know, hopefully spark some interest in some of the similar and related studies. So I'll go through this just briefly. I probably could have deleted some of these slides, but we're creating this research engine. As I said, it's all great when these things happen, when these big ideas with, you know, we're going to create this giant network and get everybody together and we're going to make a huge difference. But how you actually do that will have a big impact on the longevity of it and its success. So one of the things that we're doing is working on the research engine and being able to take proposals from anyone. So anyone would be able to submit a proposal for a project, for an idea, for you know, something that's educational related to autism and physical health, and it would be reviewed through the AARP network. Once it was reviewed and approved, then we would try to create what we're calling a research package. So for any of you who have conducted your own primary data collection, you know that there's a lot. You have to have consent forms for individuals, IRB. IRB can be a lot of fun to go through all of the details with. So the research package will have templates for all of these different materials that would be needed in order to conduct a certain study. So for example, the LEND clinic that I was talking about earlier, that we're creating some educational materials to be able to provide more information for primary care providers, we will turn it into a research study. So there will be, you know, modules, you know, and online tools that they'll be able to use. And then we will put that package through the research network so that then anybody within the AARP network would be able to download all the materials that they need in order to conduct this study, you know, pre and post test for the physicians and for the staff after receiving, you know, this intervention focused on giving them more education for treating autistic individuals in their clinics. So anyone would be able to download that information and then actually conduct that study or use those resources at their institution. And then the data is then uploaded back into the AARP database so that then we have this big database. It's a very rich database that has data on from different variables from autistic individuals across the United States. So that is one of the big goals of the research engine, because out of that, then we will be able to disseminate this information there are a lot of details. I could give an hour presentation just on the database itself and on some of the things that all go into it. But I will not bore you with all of, all of those details, although it is pretty interesting in the intricacies of making sure that this is all done in a meaningful way with access for individuals to be able to analyze data, afterwards, and also the ability for us to be able to track individuals across time. So if somebody enrolls in a study at the University of Kentucky in 2020, we have a unique identifier that will track them so that if they enroll in 2054 in a study at UCLA, we will be able to know that that's the same individual and be able to look at some of the differences across time. So as I said, anyone can join the research network. We're really trying to encourage more research, we're trying to capture individuals early in their research careers and try to encourage them by facilitating, some of the different typically difficult situations, but try to encourage them to conduct research in autism and physical health. And we strongly encourage individuals with lived experience to join. So autistic individuals, individuals with neurodevelopmental disabilities, people who have, family members who have autism, other neurodevelopmental disabilities. So I'll talk a little bit more about the ARRB, and then we'll wrap up and have some time for questions. So I have been extremely fortunate in my research career to work with quite a few pretty phenomenal individuals and groups of researchers, including at HSU and during my graduate studies at UCLA. The Autistic Researchers Review Board is hands down one of the coolest groups that I have ever worked with. Due to the time zones and everybody, being across the United States and a few in Canada and in the UK, no matter what time of day I send an email to this group, I always get a response, usually very quickly. And they're all very, very intelligent researchers, but they're also very willing to share information in a very respectful way. So we have very productive conversations, but we talk about some really difficult issues. So as I said, these are eight individuals who all identify as having autism, and they are all researchers. So obviously with the fact that they are researchers and that they are highly educated individuals, there comes a certain amount of privilege, right? They always first ask that we acknowledge the privilege that they have in their roles as researchers and that they're not representative of all autistic people. We are currently in the process of setting up some different systems to make sure that we're really hearing from the autistic community as a whole as much as we can. You can't generalize to an entire, ginormous group of people, but trying to understand and get more feedback from the autistic community is definitely a goal. And as I said before, the focus is really to try to increase or to improve the health and well-being of autistic people as defined by autistic people. So we're not trying to do what I think is needed in the, in the field. We're trying to do what autistic researchers think is needed in the field. So they have outlined some primary goals. In the interest of time, I am going to skip more to their research priorities. So we'll talk a little bit more about neurodiversity and about what well-being really means. But the ARRB is also focused on these provider and system barriers to accessing medical care. There's some differences within communication, interceptive difficulties, and some different things that are unique to autism that can lead to some barriers in receiving, assessments and, in treatment and, in care across the board. We've seen that that understanding physical health really means that they need to understand issues at the patient level, right? To understand what individuals need, but also we need to see these bigger systems, provider level, but also population level systems, which is partially being done by our health systems and services node. And we also, again, really want to make sure that we're incorporating the subjective experiences of autistic individuals themselves. So neurodiversity, drop an N, the letter N in the chat, if you have ever heard of or at all familiar with the neurodiversity movement or neurodiversity initiatives. So what the neurodiversity movement is really getting at is, I love this quote, is that the diversity of human brains is every bit as crucial for the human race as biodiversity is for life in general. So as we discussed earlier, autism is, approximately as common as red hair or green eyes. So it is a typical variation within within the human population. The neurodiversity movement is really, not for curing autism, especially, autistic individuals don't think that they need to be cured. I very much so agree with them. Having this neurodiversity within the population is positive and makes a positive impact in quite a few different areas. There are three, kind of main things that the ARRB always talks about related to the neurodiversity movement, that it's not just about autism. It also includes ADHD, learning disabilities, really many other neuro minorities. And it does accept the teaching of adaptive skills. There is some, issues related to ABA, which again could be an entire separate talk, that sometimes people think that autistic individuals are against ABA across the board, really any, learning of adaptive skills. And that's not a blanket statement, isn't quite the case. There's some more nuances there. And then also, it is accepted by the individuals that are really active within the neurodiversity movement that there are certain things that, that having more of a cure or oriented approach to are appropriate. So like epilepsy, right? Trying to cure epilepsy or, diabetes and different things of the sort definitely makes sense. But trying to cure autism, it's not all in line with the neurodiversity movement or that there are that we really need to have, this diversity within our general population. So the ARRB really focuses on the PERMA model of well-being, which you may have learned about in some of your classes. And they use that framework to determine if the projects that are being proposed will actually improve autistic people's well-being. We've seen previously that sometimes people will talk about, well-being in kind of an abstract way and not have a definite measure or really a good operational definition of well-being and how it is that, that it's trying to be increased or trying to better the well-being of individuals. So this PERMA model that focuses on positive emotions, engagement, positive relationships, meaning, the sense that one's life has direction, and accomplishments. So feeling of competency and mastery. So again, focusing on well-being is something that would be helpful for all individuals. I'm sure quite a few of you, while being in school or, or for the professors teaching during a pandemic and, shifting very quickly to this virtual model, there's been hopefully a focus on self-care for quite a few of you, which gets at a few different areas of well-being here. So one of the last things I want to talk about is one of the biggest things that I have learned from the Autistic Researchers Review Board, and it's about language. I think that this has definitely been huge in 2020 and 2021 as well, but really in everybody trying to focus on their own learning on ways that we can all improve, right? So that has been something that I myself have learned quite a bit. And then all of the quote unquote experts that I work with, my colleagues have also learned quite a bit about it. So some of us have been in the field of autism research for 5 years, others for 15, 20 years. But there was one thing in common is that we all had a lot to learn about more appropriate language that we could be using and really that could be used within research in general. So the Autistic Researchers Review Board created three different tables related to language, trying to really simplify it as much as possible to be giving kind of direct information about traditional terms that are used and then the more preferred terms that could be used and that it would be better to have integrated within within research. So this talks about some of them. Like a disorder, terming something as a disorder isn't quite preferred, but terming it as a disability definitely is more so. These like comorbid is something that I've really had to, I do some clinical psychology work. And so comorbid is a term that, you know, that's used to, you know, when two things are occurring at the same time, is something that's very commonly used that I have been able to get out of my vocabulary for the most part, and to focus more so on using the term co-occurring. Risk and risk factor was something that we talked quite a bit about the ARRB with, because there are, like, you have a risk for diabetes, right? You know, and so there are certain things that using the term risk is really appropriate for. So in a lot of the co-occurring conditions, however, not when you're actually talking about autism, because again, autism, you know, within the neurodiversity movement isn't seen as this terrible negative thing that we're trying to eradicate, but more as a, you know, a typical variation in the population that is celebrated by many individuals. So this continues a term that is trying to be phased out as of more recently within autism research, but is unfortunately still really commonly used, is high functioning and low functioning autism, which some of you may be familiar with those terms. So it's much more helpful to actually talk about the individual characteristics of that person. As I said earlier, if you've met one person with autism, you've met one person with autism. So really describing that person specifically more is helpful versus trying to give a really generalized label to their to the way that they go about life and, you know, the different things that they are able to do. It also focuses a little bit less on a deficit-based, you know, model, a little bit more on a strengths-based approach, because even when, you know, when I'm talking to a parent of a child who is who's nonverbal, so a non-speaking individual with a lot of self-harming behaviors, who we're trying to focus on really learning general self-care, those parents can usually pull out, or almost always pull out, at least a few things about that child that are amazing and exceptional, to really be able to focus on some of the strengths of those individuals and not just come from this deficit-based approach. So those are a few things from the ARRB that are language related that have been really beneficial for us within the network to learn about, and that we have a upcoming publication that includes all of the tables that we hope will be able to make a positive impact within autism research in the greater community to try to understand some of these preferred terms by autistic individuals themselves. To end the conversation on the ARRB, again, I think it's really important that when you're integrating, it's important to integrate individuals with lived experiences into any type of research that you're doing that involves them, even if you are autistic yourself, or even if you're doing, research on sexuality and you are a sexual minority, still you need to include the greater voice of those individuals in the research that you do, and try to do so in the most meaningful way possible, actually making substantive changes based off of the feedback and information that you're getting from them. So we'll open it up for questions. As I said, I talk really fast and mumble, so I know I threw a ton of information at you all at once. One last thing, we do have a monthly webinar series that we do, that somehow it ended up that I got chosen to be the moderator for that monthly webinar series. So these are nationwide webinars that cover a different topic related to autism and physical health during the third week of the month, each month. And the upcoming webinar is focused around the using autism research to inform policy. So the successes, lessons, and challenges. And this is coming out of the team at Drexel. And so that will give you some good kind of, you know, baseline information as to what's going on in the field. And then also kind of tangible ways that they have been able to use autism research to try to make changes within policy. You know, as researchers, we're trying to make a difference in the, you know, the everyday lives of individuals, but oftentimes in order to do so, we need to be able to change policy and make sure that we have accessibility, you know, to different things, you know, and services for individuals. And a lot of times that takes a policy change, which is often slow, but eventually has some sort of an impact. There's a documentary on Netflix, Don't Be Deterred by the Name, as I originally was, called Crip Camp, that does a good job of talking about, it's created by individuals with disabilities, and it does a good job of talking about some of the history behind individuals with neurodevelopmental disabilities and how they were able to use their collective voices together to make a difference on policy. So I will pause for a few minutes. What time is it? Yeah, we have a few minutes, and see if anybody has any questions. Feel free to drop them in the chat or to unmute and speak up if you feel comfortable. How do we get this home model care at UCLA? Thank you to those who have posted information in the chat. It's always helpful when you're giving a lecture. I'm sure your professors have said things about, like, I'm just staring into the abyss of these tiny black boxes on my screen and nobody is there. So it's always nice to get questions from individuals. And it also then helps me understand what I should be talking more about. How do we get this this home model care at UCLA? So the medical home model. As I said, it's quite it takes quite a few resources to be able to provide, you know, kind of this level of care. There will be information that is available soon that will be provided to primary care physicians across the country to try to increase their knowledge in treating autistic individuals. When I say treating, I mean treating their everyday, like, you know, not treating the autism, but treating their everyday medical conditions. But I'll drop my email in the chat right now. And if anybody has any questions or wants follow-up information, feel free to reach out. I am more than happy to help.
While we wait for questions to come in, I'm not saying anybody can't provide questions, please do. I do just wanna give a quick thank you to Kashia for her amazing presentation today, because I do know we're kind of reaching that hour where people do have to go for classes or this, that, and the other. So please provide questions in the chat. Again, if you're not comfortable speaking up, please feel free to DM myself, Bernardo, Edgar, or Kevin Cherry. We'll ask on your behalf, but a big round of applause for those who are here, for Kashia for providing an excellent talk and amazing information on where to go to get involved and possibly attached to some of these resources in the future if you're curious. So just a thank you. Thank you again for such an amazing talk today.
Yeah, thank you, Aaron. I'm really impressed with how much more active the psych talks have been, and how much you guys have built out the system. When I was leaving UCLA, I think was the first year that psych talks were, I think they may have existed like a long time ago, but the first time that they were really back. So there was a few psych talks my last year at UCLA that were really interesting, and it was awesome. I remember we'd get excited when the room would be full. What's that room when you walk out of the, like on the other side? When that room would be full, we'd get really excited that there was actually like quite a few people there. So it's amazing to see over 40 participants, even though it's virtual, it's amazing to see so many participants going to the psych talk. So that's really cool.
Yeah, we started back in, I think, spring of 2016, I believe it is. And that's psych 166. Yeah, we quickly graduated to KBR.
That's nice. Yeah, I think Dr. Tibide, I think that you and Dr. Gaffney were, that was your first year. My last year was both of your first years, right?
I think so. Yeah, we started in 2015. So yeah.
Yeah, that would make sense. Yep. That would make sense. And Dr. Agner had been there for, I think, year or two when I was leaving, but was relatively new at that point in time too. Yeah, it's cool to see what the psych department has done in the last 5 years. It's pretty impressive. If anybody has or wants any additional information or has any questions, feel free to email me. I drop my email in the chat, so feel free to email me. I'm always happy to help and communicate with students in any way that I can.
Sensing no more questions or seeing no questions pop up in the chat, or maybe for those of you who are waiting for the recording to end, we're gonna end the recording here. So for those of you who are watching this recording after it's put up, for those to watch later, thank you for watching. If you're curious, both in the call or later, we do have an additional 3 psych talks remaining in the semester. So for those of you who enjoy these talks, please be on the lookout for future events. We are not done. Also, we have some additional professional development seminar events coming up as well, which will run parallel to our psych talks. More info on those later. But if you are watching the video, thank you very much for watching, and we will see you in the next Psych Talk.